sunshine. As seen by Qatar Airways passengers. Your five-star airline. Sponsored by Qatar Airways.
The creator of brilliant, often radical designs, and the master planner for the Ground Zero site.
A building is like falling in love with someone.
Learn about his history, remarkable buildings, and dreams for the future. Daniel Libitskin, The Making of an Architect, a two-part special beginning Monday at 9:30 p.m. on Channel News Asia. This program is brought to you by Reflections at Keppel Bay, setting new benchmarks in world-class waterfront living. Threaten. Invade. Warfare. Sacrifice. Providing Asian perspectives in an ever-changing landscape. Channel News Asia.
A tornado in eastern China kills at least 14 people and injures close to 150 others. Winds of over 100 kilometers per hour destroyed over 700 houses in Anhui province and another 100 in neighboring Jiangsu. Meantime, the country's top environmental watchdog has punished several cities and dozens of factories for chronic river pollution. Six cities, two counties, and five industrial parks have been blacklisted for their role in polluting four major rivers. And thunderstorms are continuing in southern Japan, where heavy rain caused a train to derail from a landslide. Seven people were on board when the train was dragged off the tracks. No injuries were reported. And those are the main stories. This is Channel News Asia.
What is Gaia?
Gaia?
Gaia is how do you perform, but Gaia.
It's a brand of something.
Isn't that a dancer?
Never heard it.
We don't know who Gaia is, sorry.
It's a bread jump. Gaia.
Gaia, God? Mythological name for Earth.
Do I know what Gaia is?
Gaia.
Yeah, planet Earth. We should take care of the planet. It's our mother.
Talk to me. Talk to me. If you feel the need when you need the feeling, talk to me. If you feel the need when you need the feeling, talk to me.
The car has evolved from means of transport to a transport of means. Hello, everyone. I'm Timothy Goh, and another exciting episode here on That's IT. What I'm trying to say is the car used to take us from point A to B. And then it evolved into something that took us from point A to B in style. And now it's evolving into something else. So join me on this journey, pardon the pun, looking into the technologies that power the motoring world.
Whenever the word power is used in conversation about cars, we normally think of horsepower, torque, and how fast a car can go. Yet power, in the conventional sense, is just one piece of a greater motoring puzzle. Power can also mean how smart a car is.
Certainly there are cars that are full of features as well, but depends on a point of view. Some people look at a smart car as which car has the most features and most gadgets and stuff like that. In which case, a luxury sedan like a BMW 7 Series or a Lexus LS might have all the bells and whistles, a good audio system, DVD player, navigation and stuff like that. So certainly you could call those a smart car.
Where power is knowledge, a car might be considered powerful simply because it's equipped with a certain amount of intelligent gadgets. I'm now looking at such a car that has the sugar to make commuting a really sweet experience.
Good afternoon, sir.
Hey, hi, just the man I'm looking for. This car is fabulous.
Yes, it
is.
Tell
me more about it.
Sure, allow me to show you the features.
I was told you can convert it into a moving office. How does that work?
First of all, by pulling this lever, pops up the mini table.
Wow, okay.
And you can place your laptop on the top of the table.
Of course, a laptop or any electrical device for that matter needs power to run.
We have this outlet, and we have a power outlet over here. What we've got to do is plug it in. This.
Just goes into your laptop.
Yeah.
That's cool.
And there you go, you can do your office work.
All right.
Check this out, Bluetooth connectivity. All I've got to do is activate it, and I can talk hands-free. Where your car is your office, you can take your work and cruise on the job.
What are these for?
This gadget is for the DVD entertainment system. It comes with the Mark Levinson 19 speakers. What you got to do is open up the screen.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And there you have, you can watch your movies.
Well, this car comes with all sorts of creature comforts to turn your car into a living room.
And you have a 4-liter storage box over here. You may do your drinks. And the air conditioning.
Mm-hmm.
It has an infrared metric sensor here, so it detects your body temperature. So, for example, if the body is warm, it will lower the air condition automatically until your body feels comfortable. This is the best feature of the car that I like best. By switching it on, it converts your chair into a massager chair. You can raise your leg up.
What about that? A spa in a car. What will they think of next? A jacuzzi, perhaps?
I'm amazed at how quiet this car is moving.
This is a luxury sedan car, which makes it more insulated than other cars.
Certainly good enough for me to record a guitar concerto.
Besides being a luxury sedan, it's also a high-performance car.
I just wonder, who would buy a car like this?
Those who buy the LS600 hybrid are what we call the super affluent. They are those who would like the comfort and luxury of a big-size sedan, who like the performance coming from the car. And of course, I think they are those who care for the environment, as this is an environment-friendly car.
Well, I can still remember those good old days when power windows and leather seats were reserved for top-of-the-line cars. But now, they come pretty standard, so don't be surprised one day when your Vios will come with massage chairs as well.
The ultimate smart car would be one that tests the boundaries of automotive engineering, empowers technology to drive itself, and render the driver redundant. This is Stanley, a concept driverless car by Volkswagen. It comes really close to achieving just that.
Stanley obviously uses a lot of electronics, and we have seen that coming in the last decade. There was more and more electronics coming into the car, and this is certainly going to continue. The electronics they use for it, especially what I see coming, is more and more driver assistance systems. We'll have more systems that will increase the safety for the driver in the car, and also the fun of driving and the comfort.
Remember, Stanley is still a concept car, so don't expect to find it in your showroom. The Stanley embodies a technology that inspires other car makers to build cars for the next generation with advanced driving assist function. But when we return, we'll show you a car that will keep you safe on the road. So don't drive anywhere.
Now is your chance to vote for your favorite contestant. The lines are open, so vote now.
It toppled governments, bankrupted entire nations, and claimed the careers of political leaders. The Asian financial crisis. 10 years on, look back at the event that shook markets around the world and the remarkable recovery of the region. Tiger, Tiger, Burning Bright, an exclusive Channel News Asia production for Documentary of the Week, Sunday at 7:30 p.m.
Ever wondered what it's like to be driven by a car? Well, it might sound like a scene from your sci-fi movie, but the fact is, the seeds of a car being driven by the computer has already been sown.
We are coming to a time when cars can eventually drive themselves, and some of these technology can be found in cars with adaptive cruise control systems.
While it may not be as futuristic as what the Stanley may have, the adaptive cruise control system found in the new Volvo S80 is the autonomous driving technology you'll find in the real world.
If you put your desired speed and the car in front of you slows down, then the radar detects that there's a car in front of you and it slows down with reducing your engine torque, or you can apply the brakes up to 30% of the brake capacity. But it's only down to a speed of 30, and then you have to take over your action yourself. And end of the day, you're the responsible, because you're driving the car. So we're just helping you. So now we're using adaptive cruise control. You feel it's breaking down. I don't touch the pedals or anything. Mm-hmm. When the distance is... When it's clear enough, it drives off, and then the car picks up the speed again.
So it does pick up again?
Yes, it does pick up to the whatever speed you set to it.
Okay.
So if you want to have shorter distance, then we can have that too. So you can adjust it to whatever, I mean, the driving conditions you are in actually right now. And this works to down to a speed of 30 kilometers per hour. So you use the collision warning. It tells you like this, that if you're, oh, guy, you have to, I mean, brake, you're approaching a collision, so he will warn you that.
But does it brake for you?
He just prepares the brakes for you.
Prepares the brakes.
Yeah, that's meaning it is close, everything is tighter up. So, I mean, when you step on the brakes, you get the efficiency there immediately. It's no delays.
So you've heard and seen. The adaptive cruise control doesn't drive for you. Instead, it functions like a clever driver sidekick, but in no way does it overrule the driver. Besides the adaptive cruise control, the S80 has other ways to keep you safe.
Some other personal safety, if we talk about, is the PCC, the key, actually, personal car communicator that you have on the new Asadian. We're using a heartbeat sensor in the car that will detect it as a heartbeat. Together with a heartbeat sensor, that if, for instance, the alarm has been triggered, that you can check if somebody's inside the car. Because we have a heartbeat sensor in the car that detects if there's some heartbeat in the car. And then you will have two LED lights here flashing for you that tell you, hey, it's somebody in the car.
Well, that comes pretty useful if you don't wish unexpected company popping up from behind you with a rope, a knife, or worse. For those who can't afford the asking price of a high-spec luxury sedan, After Gadgets might just be the solution to make your standard car a little smarter. One example would be the S1000, a GPS navigational system by Tebow.
Aftermarket GPS navigation devices is commonly referred to as a personal navigation device, and that basically is a small computing unit that incorporates a GPS chip. This GPS chip then has the ability to communicate with satellites so that the device can geolocate itself on the Earth. So what happens is the user, when they're using the device, are able to see with the digital map exactly where they are.
To see how effective the aftermarket navigational device is, we put it through a test.
The only thing that we need to set is to set the destination. So once you set the destinations and the GPS reads where your car is or your vehicle is, and automatically it will reach there and it will calculate you to your destination. So for now, I have set to One Trani Road, which is at Singapore Botanical Gardens.
At the roundabout, take the sixth exit.
For someone who easily gets lost in the urban maze, a navigational set like the Tebow certainly comes in handy. Even when we've made a wrong turn, the device resets and sends us back on track. I bet if only Little Red Riding Hood had a navigational device, she'd probably be able to steer clear of the big bad wolf. While most modern cars these days come with factory-installed stereo sets, there will always be those who aspire for bigger and better in-car entertainment systems. For the perfectionist in sound with a budget to match, upgrading would seem a very viable option.
We do see a surge in head units which are able to connect to storage medium, products like thumb drive, hard disk drive. We also see a surge also in some development in the digital audio broadcasting segment and also DVDs.
As Blaupunkt is one brand expanding into car multimedia, we ask for a sample of in-car entertainment systems we can find in the market.
Basically, what you see here is a Seattle MP57, which has a 3.5 TFT screen, capabilities to fit to an outboard memory card. It can also fit thumb drive. At the same time, you can load up a hard disk drive. Okay. On the second head unit, you see here is a Bluetooth Hamburg MP57 head unit, which once you go on board the car, what you do is you pair your mobile phone with the radio, and then that's it. You can do over-the-air conversation. You can pick the calls from the radio itself, or you can end the calls from the radio itself. Last but not least, the lower end head unit, the Kingston MP37, which has also a USB connector. What you also see here is a 3.5mm jack, which you can aux in to a portable MP3 device. For all three head units that you see here, there are capabilities to interface with iPod, also an MP3 player.
The Lamborghini, a name people normally associate with ultra-high-performance automobiles. Even on a standstill, this exotic supercar seems to exude a powerful sense of speed. However, ownership comes with a price tag that's, at least to say, very steep. For us who can't afford the Italian stallion, you may check out a notebook that's named after the exotic sports machine.
Basically, Asus and Lamborghini have worked together to come up with this Asus Lamborghini VX2 notebook. The exterior of the notebook is actually very much similar to the Lamborghini car. We are the first to come up with the leather-bound palm rest with yellow stitches, and also there is a wheel fan lid underneath the notebook, which is very much similar to the sports rim of the Lamborghini car as well.
Unlike the car, of course, the notebook is retailed at a somewhat affordable price tag of just over $3,000. A really smart way to own a Lamborghini, if you ask me. Say what you want, say what you like. For a true car enthusiast, nothing escapes the talk about how fast, how sleek, or how sexy a car is when the topic of power gets into the car conversation. So when we return, we'll have a look at what separates the boys from the men.
More than 600 militant students surrendered to authorities, but at least another 1,000 are still holed up in a mosque. For months, they've been in a standoff with police over a Taliban-style anti-vice campaign. Full reports on Primetime News.
Do I have all the knowledge to succeed in my own backyard?
What risks are involved in starting my own business here?
Will I be lost in this fast-paced world of ours?
Should we buy or should we sell?
Home is where the heart is.
Next on Adrenaline Fix Friday's Drive It. Two luxury sports cars side by side, the Alfa Romeo Brera and the Nissan 350Z. Which one surpasses the other in performance, safety and comfort? Get behind the wheels of Volvo's S80 and Audi's second generation TT. Then head to London for the British Motor Show and test drive the newest models from over 200 exhibitors. Drive it Friday at 9:30 p.m. on Channel News Asia.
Have you ever heard of drift?
Drifting was originated from Japan. It was born in 1962, where the guys raced down the togis in the mountains, and it had actually taken the world by storm, which the Japanese actually pushed it to another level.
I seriously don't understand what that's all about. As if power and speed are not enough, these so-called drifters are really testing the limits of what their reinforced muscle cars can do.
Basically, drifting is different from track racing because the cars go sideways and they are not judged on timing. Basically, they are judged on the speed, the angle, and the execution. So it's a very different from the contemporary form of motorsports, which are going for a fast time, you know, faster time wins. Drifting is not all about that. It's about driving in a controlled manner where the car is totally out of control.
Simple physics would explain that unless you're pushing very, very fast, you won't be able to spin out of control. To get that, you may need a little bit more of what your ordinary sports car can offer.
As you can see, a drift car is basically comprises of what a normal car would have. The only difference for a drift car is basically we have reinforced shock bars and engine damping. That's basically to hold the engine together when the car swerves left and right. All right? Engine basically is standard. We don't really do much to the engine because we try not to break the engine so much. So we will enhance it by doing on the IT side, which we program the computer box, the ECU, to give it better torque.
And that also explains why drift cars have to be specifically tweaked in the handling department.
As you can walk around, basically the cars are all kitted with body kits and tires. Tires are very important in drifting, basically because we have to have good tires to have front grip and for the back also, all right? As you can see, the cars inside are all fully with bucket seats, all right? These are all the bucket seats and all these are the bars which actually reinforce the rigidity of the whole car, all right? And basically, this is what a normal drift car would look like. You know, this where we enforce a lot on the safety. That's why we have the bucket seat and the harness down here. And the bars, which is to reinforce the whole car, to prevent the car from flexing. Drift cars are what they call battle car.
Indeed they are. And as you've seen, technology has a big part to play transforming cars into drift machines.
As you can see, a drift car is full of stickers. That's how you distinguish a drift car. So as you can see, the calipers of the car are pretty huge. This one, this particular mine, is using the GTR brakes. It's really upgraded brakes. The discs are actually grooved also. There's ventilated lines on it to cool down when we are traveling fast.
With all the speed and skids, isn't drifting dangerous?
Drifting is actually basically advanced driving. It's driving in a very acute angle and precision driving. That's all drifting is all about. And we don't encourage people to drive on the road. And basically, we find places like Hondo Marina or certain empty space. We rent it and we use it to practice our drifting skills. Yes, I strongly don't like people to drift on the road. It's too dangerous because it cause harm to other people.
If drifting is potentially hazardous, why the interest? What benefits can we derive from the sport?
Drifting is basically a very friendly skill and an entertaining skill that can be acquired by everybody of all races and of all age group, as long as they are able to control the wheels behind the car. We are trying to create a culture here, hope that everybody can actually share the same kind of enthusiasm towards car. And in view of that, we also hope that the culture can eventually help to promote motoring sports in Singapore as well.
The need for speed, that's what we all want, isn't it? But that's not what we always get in reality. A major software corporation saw an emerging interest in motorsports and was quick to react to trends.
Forza Motorsports, the second installment in the award-winning motorsport series. So the franchise we launched about 3 years ago. And what this is it's a simulation game. It's at the moment, it's the best simulation experience in the market today. I guess at the heart of Forza Motorsport 2 is an incredibly powerful